Hello, everybody, and welcome to Salem United Methodist Church. It's wonderful to have you here in worship today. I'm glad that you can take half an hour of your time to dedicate to worship, dedicate to stop your business and connect again with God and connect with each other, at least in a special way, different way. So I'm glad you can be with us today in worship. And as we enter into a time of worship, I'm gonna invite you to light a candle in your home. And that candle will symbolize the presence and the coming of the Spirit among us. In place of the call to worship, today we will be hearing a reading of a dramatic psalm. It's a Psalm 13, is a psalm of lament, a psalm of crying. And the reason why we are opening with that psalm is because those words are truly words that come from the heart of someone who has been suffering, someone who is anxious, someone who has been dealing with grief and sorrow, just like many of us in these days. And as we go through our life, we learn through the voice of the psalmist to turn our lament to God and to cry aloud in prayer to him. So let's hear the reading of Psalm 13.
How long, Lord, will you forget me forever? How long will you hide your face from me? How long must I wrestle with my thoughts and day after day have sorrow in my heart? How long will my enemy triumph over me? Look on me and answer, Lord my God. Give light to my eyes, or I will sleep in death. And my enemy will say, I have overcome him, and my foes will rejoice when I fall. But I trust in your unfailing love. My heart rejoices in your salvation, and I will sing the Lord's praise, for he has been good to me.
Please join me in prayer. Gracious God, as we come in your presence today, we want to lift up to you our grief, our anxiety, our fears, our anger, our sorrow, our pain, our grief this day. It's been a long journey since our life has changed dramatically. And sometimes we feel like we cannot hear your voice. Sometimes we feel like we lost the sense of hope and direction. Sometimes we feel like maybe this will last forever. Why, God, don't you intervene? Why don't you come in our help? And yet, gracious God, as we take the courage to use our prayers as a lament to you, as a complaint for everything that is going on, we lift up in a special way those that we love and are not well, those that we know they are in a special need of you and your presence. We lift up to you all those places, close and far, who are filled with anger, hostility, separation, division. We lift up to you all those who are still dying alone. And for those families who are brokenhearted, that they cannot even be with their loved one at the end of their lives. We lift up all those who are in charge of making difficult decisions every day. and they have to live with the guilt and failures. And in the end, we lift up ourselves, gracious God, because we need to find a voice to come to you in prayer and in faith, trusting you that in ways that we don't know, you are working already through us, around us, and for us, for healing and transformation. So, gracious God, listen to our prayers. Come to us, help us to hear your voice in the midst of everything that is happening. And help us in the midst of everything to smile, to find hope, to see new life, to see the fruits that are blossoming within us and in nature, to be able to celebrate new life that it comes, notwithstanding everything else that is happening. The miracle of your life that is stronger than any death is still here again. So, gracious God, we come together as a family, as a community, as brother and sister, together with our brother Jesus Christ in prayer with the words that he taught us. Our Father who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen.
Today's scripture is Galatians chapter 5, verse 1, and verses 13 through 21 from the New Revised Standard Version of the Bible. For freedom, Christ has set us free. Stand firm, therefore, and do not submit again to the yoke of slavery. For you are called to freedom, brothers and sisters, only do not use your freedom as an opportunity for self-indulgence, but through love become slaves to one another. For the whole law is summed up in a single commandment, you shall love your neighbor as yourself. If, however, you bite and devour one another, take care that you are not consumed by one another. Live by the Spirit, I say, and do not gratify the desires of the flesh. For what the flesh desires is opposed to the Spirit, and what the Spirit desires is opposed to the flesh. For these are opposed to each other to prevent you from doing whatever you want. But if you are led by the Spirit, you are not subject to law. Now the works of the flesh are obvious: fornication, impurity, licentiousness, idolatry, sorcery, enmity, strife, jealousy, anger, quarrels, dissensions, factions, envy, drunkenness, carousing, and things like these. I am warning you as I have warned you before, those who do such things will not inherit the kingdom of God.
I love this time of the year in Wisconsin, late summer. It's a time of growth and fruits and harvest. It's really, truly a blessed time. And I love to go with my mask to see our people gardens and see what they grow. And here are some of the pictures that they sent me about the beautiful tomatoes that they have and the peppers and a tree with the fruits coming and more peppers and zucchinis. Beautiful blessing from God. It's amazing how goodness grows in spite of everything that happens in our lives or around the world. It's kind of a surprising that even though we have to put hard work to grow those fruits and those vegetables, God works his miracle and surprises with things that are always better than what we expected to be. Let's now, for instance, see how this works. Let's start with an apple, right? So inside the apples are seeds, and that's the beginning of everything. So we wanted to grow an apple tree, we need to get the seeds and put it in the ground. And then, of course, it takes care and water. But then at one point or another, there is this incredible miracle of God, a miracle of growth. And then the seeds become, in an amazing way, a little plant. And with our nursing and caring and watering and maybe cut dry branches, this becomes a beautiful tree, and eventually it gives us the fruits. Again, they are the results of God's creation with our hard work. Today we're going to start a new worship series that will take us through the month of September that is entitled Where Goodness Grows. And we are going to talk about fruits. We're going to talk about the work that we need to make in order to have fruits, and the work that God does in incredible ways to provide fruits for us. Except that instead of being the fruits of the ground, we're going to talk about the spiritual fruits, the fruits of the Spirit. And Paul, the apostle, in the letter to the church in Galatia, he lists the gifts of the Spirit, that they come when we practice goodness, when we grow goodness, and it's love, joy, kindness, peace, patience, generosity, faithfulness, gentleness, and self-control. Those are the fruits that come with our work, with growing goodness and kindness and love in our lives, and then God's Spirit growing them and making it become fruit of blessing and healing in our lives. Now, Paul, the Apostle Paul, was writing to the church in Galatia. And he was writing because he was extremely concerned about what was going on there. He created that church. He loved that church. He did everything in his power to help that church to grow in a healthy and strong community. But he is filled with concern. Things are not going well. And you heard the words of the reading of Galatians. He's filled with harsh words. He's hurt. He's almost angry and upset. And he goes to them and say, what did you do? Why, instead of growing love and kindness and patience and gentleness, you find yourself filled with anger and separation and fights and immorality? Things are not going well. He speaks to them because he's the one who brought Christ to them. They were all Gentiles, so they had not knowledge of the God of Israel. They didn't even know that they could be children of that God. And Paul is the one to say, You are loved by Christ. Christ went on the cross also for you, and he freed you. He made you free women and free men, and that freedom that he gave to you cost a high price. He sacrificed himself on the cross to give you that freedom, so that you are free from burden, you are free from pressure, you are free from sin, from addiction, and you are free from whatever is happening around your life. Now you are free to love. That was the message that he gave to them. Yet, something happened, and the people, community of Galatia, misunderstood the meaning of that freedom. And they began to see devastating consequences for that misunderstanding. And Paul got his heart broken. And what he does is he turns with complaint and sorrow and even anger. The word that he uses in the scripture is lament that we find. Like the lament that we heard in the beginning of this service by hearing the Psalm 13. Many scriptures in the Bible are a prayer of lament. And so he speaks to them and he said to them, you misunderstood what I tried to tell you. You use freedom to self-serve yourself, to serve your own interest, your wish and your desire. But that's not the kind of freedom that you receive from Christ. The kind of freedom you receive is a gift, and is a gift that brings life. Instead, you are using freedom to do your own business, to take care of your own things, your own interests, and your own opinions. And so doing, you instead grew dissension and quarrels and jealousy and anger and drunkenness and perusing. Let me tell you, said Paul, this is not going to create community. And worse, this is going to lead you from not being able to be part of the kingdom of God. Some of you may be surprised in hearing these harsh words from Paul. This kind of loud disapproval coming out of his mouth. You know, sometimes we think about Christians, they're people always joyful. They praise, they're sweet, they're meek, and they're merciful and gentle, which is part of what it means to be Christian. But let me be clear that being a people of faith, it doesn't mean that we are passive. It doesn't mean that we accept those things that are wrong. It doesn't mean that we let injustice and we let anything that goes against goodness to take over in our own lives. And so the scripture is filled with people of all sorts, from Job to David, all the way to all the Psalms, and of course to Jesus Christ, who complain, turn to God and complain aloud their sorrow, their pain, their grief, their anger. And we're going to call this holy complaint. It's a special kind of complaint. So I don't want anybody, any of you now, at the end of the service, turn to your spouse and say, go and do these dishes. You didn't do the dish. I'm going to complain. And Paula, Pastor Paula said that it's okay. This is only complaint. That's not only complaint. If you complain because of the weather or because you have to stand in line or because you have to wait for things, that's not exactly holy complaint. That's actually not at all holy complaint. Holy complaint is an act of faith. It's a spiritual practice of mourning and naming the things that are wrong in our life and in our community and call God in our lives to repair it. It's actually an action of faith. Is a practice, a spiritual practice of prayer. And also, it's a lament can be a repentance for our own wrongs, asking God to come and heal what is broken in our own lives. Lament is indeed part of the scripture. And God, the last words of God were on the cross on this earth, were words of lament. my God, why you forsaken me? Why you are in silence? What are you doing? Come and do something to heal. Speak up. In abandonment, in grief, exhaustion, and anxiety, and sorrow, we often feel that might be rude and inappropriate to lament to God. But remember, silence is a spiritual killer. And bringing our complaint to God is actually an action of faith and is a part of our prayer life. It's an act of faith, trusting God. I truly believe that what happened 2,000 years ago in the community of Galatia, their misunderstanding of freedom and the consequences that that brought in their community, it's what we are experiencing in a very similar way in our own community these days, in our own city, county, and nation, and even in the world. Just like that, we feel entitled to our freedom. We don't think that freedom is a gift that has been given to us, that Christ paid a high price for it. We feel that it's the ability to do what I want and when I want, that I'm my own boss, that freedom is the way for me to show my own rights, my like and my dislikes. And here we can hear it once again, through century, the words of the Apostle Paul that tell us, you forgot that freedom is a gift. And instead of growing goodness, you are self-serving and going against the people that you don't like, that you hatred. You're serving your own opinions and your own personal visions. In so doing, the results are painful and our immorality, anger, hostility, division, polarization. Sounds familiar, everybody? I can assure you that things are not going to improve in the next few months, at least in this country. And I also feel that goodness, growing goodness, is something that we've been losing. It seems that we forget that we are indeed the part and called to grow goodness and kindness and love and sacrifice and service to others. The fruit of the Spirit appeared to be sometime something that we have forgotten, they are endangered. Paul is very clear about the results of this misunderstanding of freedom. And he calls to God and to us once again to remember that Christ, he said, for freedom Christ has set you free. Stand firm, therefore, and do not submit again to a yoke of slavery. For you were called to live in freedom, brothers and sisters. Only do not use that freedom as an opportunity for self-indulgence. Remember, freedom becomes real and powerful only when you learn how to serve and love your neighbor. And by the way, this understanding of freedom, it's the foundation of this country. If you go and read the Declaration of Independence in 1776, that's exactly what it is. Freedom is to be able to serve others. So here's my invitation to you for this week that is about to start. First of all, practice holy complaint. Make sure that you bring your laments to God, your anger, your sorrow, your frustration, your anxiety, and know that He's the one that can transform it in a new possibility. Remember, silence kills the spirit. Instead, lament is the very first big step of faith. We should not be quiet when things are not right, and we should speak up when it's necessary to do so. Second of all, remember to embrace the freedom that has been given to you as an opportunity to love and serve, and not self-serve. And also remember that when you do so, that kind of freedom becomes very contagious. No matter where you are, if you are in your community, at home, at work, or even on Facebook, or even in a store, when you use freedom as an opportunity to give something to others and change completely the atmosphere around you, and everybody will see the fruit of the spirits of joy and happiness and faithfulness and kindness grow right there in the middle of all this happening. So start growing goodness again. Even if that means that you go kind of against the flow, the fruits of your work will become visible through the Spirit of God. And that all start with me, and all start with you. Amen. This is a special time during our service when we reflect over not just the spiritual fruits of our lives, but also the material fruits of our life that come out of our work that God empowers to do. And this time, I'm going to invite you all on a regular basis to consider to take a portion of those fruits and put it aside and use them for the growth of the kingdom of God through the ministry of Salem. So make sure that you use an envelope, a special envelope or a regular envelope, and send it in so that even in the midst of the time that we live, we are able to keep growing hope and growing generosity. May this time of offering be a blessing to you all. And as we prepare to come to an end to this service, may the Spirit of God be with you and give you the courage to lament your pain, bring forward the injustice, speak up when things are not going well, and yet constantly go in the hands of God, asking Him to bring healing and transformation. May the freedom that has been given to you be with you, so that allow you to live as a free person in Christ, as an opportunity to serve each other. And may the Spirit of God be with you now and forever. Amen.